Okay, shall we start with the second talk? Second talk is by Professor Yaron Oss. Professor Yaron Oss has been the rector of Tel Aviv University since 2015. Not that long, 2015. He has made important contributions to high energy particles physics, quantum field theories, and supersymmetry, classical and quantum gravity, and superstrings. He is the incumbent of the UFO Newman Chair of Physics and the recipient of the Humboldt Research Award. He has headed the Center for Excellence in Research of the National Science Foundation. He was the president of the Israel Physical Society from 2013 to 2016, and is currently the chair of the National Committee for Pure and Applied Sciences of the Israeli Academy of Sciences. It is now my great pleasure to call upon Professor Yaron Oss to talk about what is it? Spontaneous symmetry breaking, conformal, anomaly, and incompressible fluid turbulence.
Thank you. It's a great pleasure to be here. I'd like to thank the organizers for the invitation. Let me begin with a story. There is a story about Heisenberg. His PhD thesis was on turbulence. And he was asked, when he meets God, what will be the question that he's going to ask? And he said, I have two questions. The first question will be, why relativity? And the second question will be, why turbulence? I think God will have an answer to the first question. Turbulence is one of these problems that is very broad and wide, in the sense that if we will understand the principles of turbulence, we will understand principles of a large number of systems that are far from equilibrium. But it's also very deep. Very deep in the sense that to formulate it, it's very easy. It's basically Newton's second law. But to really understand turbulence, you will probably need to understand deep principles of physics. To me, it always reminds Fermat's last theorem, right? If somebody shows you the problem, it's very easy to understand. The first thing you say, okay, why don't you try to prove it by mathematical induction? Then you need to develop a whole machinery of algebraic geometry to do that. In turbulence, there are actually two problems. One, we can call it the clay problem. It's a question about existence of solutions. It's a mathematical problem, but it has some physical importance. I will say very little about it. The second, we can call it the Nobel problem, is the one to understand the scaling regime of turbulence. Now, the plan of the talk is the following. First, I will tell you how I got into turbulence, because I'm a high energy physicist. And the reason I got into it is coming from gravity. Thinking about it in this way allows me to think about it in a geometrical way. And so I'm going to propose a geometrical solution of the problem. There will be certain principles that will be involved in this. One of them, spontaneous scale symmetry breaking. It's a very special one. It's a spontaneous symmetry breaking in a novel way of space and time to a diagonal subgroup. I will propose something which I will call turbulence field theory, and I will tell you how scale anomaly enters in this business to fix what is called intermittency. And then there will be some outlook. So first of all, what is turbulence? Turbo is the Latin word for crowd. And turbulence originally refers to the disorderly motion of a crowd. So for instance, you hear turbulence in the Middle East, turbulence in the White House. But scientifically, it refers to a complex and unpredictable motion of a fluid. However, even though I'm going to stick to the scientific part, nowadays it's very clear that many physical ideas apply to social systems, so I believe that this will also have importance there, understanding turbulence. Now, turbulence is considered to be one of the major unsolved problems of physics, probably the most important classical physics problem that is unsolved. But there is a first question, is what is turbulence? Now, one answer would be, you know it when you see it. If I'll ask you, what do you see in this picture? You will tell me, we see turbulence. But this is not a good enough a way to tackle the problem. And for me, the definition of turbulence will be the existence of a universal scaling regime where there are scaling exponents, universal scaling exponents that one can measure and try to calculate. Now, most fluid motions in nature at all scales, they are turbulent. This is actually an environmental fact I will show you because of the numbers of values of certain parameters in our universe didn't have to be like that. But because of that, everything you see is turbulent. Aircraft motions, river flows, atmospheric phenomena, astrophysical, even blood flows, or in condensed matter physics, electron fluids in certain material systems like graphene, et cetera, they will all show turbulence in an appropriate regime. And despite centuries of research, and by centuries I basically mean five centuries since Leonardo da Vinci, people have been trying to understand this, and we still lack an analytical description and understanding of the fluid flows in what we call the nonlinear regime. And as I said before, it's not only about turbulence, but if we'll understand it, we will probably understand the principles of a large systems that are very far from equilibrium and have large number of strongly interacting degrees of freedom. Now, there's one thing that is always confusing about this field. People ask, how can it be far from equilibrium if in the whole business there is a derivative expansion? And the answer is that it's locally in equilibrium. Globally, it's far from equilibrium. Now, how does gravity get into this business? It's basically, for me, it's mostly an inspiration, as you will see. But Einstein's equations, they do not have dissipative effects. They are not dissipative. Einstein's theory is not a dissipative theory. However, if you put black holes there, then you create dissipation, because classically, things, fields that fall into the black hole, they cannot emerge back. And this is what this is the way that we introduce dissipation in the problem. Now, because gravity is described by geometry, then it means that in a way that I will explain, you can geometrize turbulence. So instead of thinking about turbulence as a problem in fluids, you can think about it as a problem in geometry. Now, you could say that why do you care? Because you take one complicated nonlinear problem, you map it to another complicated nonlinear problem. So what are you going to gain from that? Actually, you will see that I can gain many things. Now, this will be the only thing where I'm going to use something about black hole physics, because after that, it is going to be basically field theory analysis. But I would like to explain what do I mean by geometrization of the fluid variables. And actually, already in the 70s and the 80s, people tried to understand what is the dynamics of the black hole horizon. And the first work that actually I read was a thesis by Thibaut Amour, where he did analyze that. And they saw that the dynamics of the horizon of a black hole, which is dictated by Einstein's equations, is fluid-like, and they developed a whole field called membrane paradigm. But they didn't exactly get fluids, and the reason was very simple. When they were doing what is, they were working in asymptotically flat spaces. In asymptotically flat spaces, the horizon of the black hole is a sphere. The important thing about hydrodynamics is that there is a small expansion parameter, a derivative expansion. It's the ratio of the mean free path or the correlation length divided by the characteristic length scale of the system. But for a spherical black hole, both scale like inverse of temperature. So this small parameter called the Knudsen number was of order one. So there was no really good hydrodynamics. However, when we repeated the analysis of Damour, but for a planar black hole, which is an example that you will have in asymptotically ADS spaces. Later, by the way, it was realized that you can do it also in asymptotically flat. Then the following thing happens. If there is a horizon of a black hole, and you kick this black hole a little bit and you deviate, so this is the new horizon. And you denote this deviation by function P, a scalar function, which I will call a pressure. And you will denote the normal by VI, we'll call it a velocity. And you ask, what Einstein's equations tell you about the equation that relates the two? These are the Navier-Stokes equations. Now, of course, Einstein's equations are relativistic, so you'll get relativistic Navier-Stokes equations, and then you can take a non-relativistic limit, you will get actual Navier-Stokes equations. There is a whole field that I'm not going to use, which is called fluid gravity correspondence, that many people in the Tata group and others contributed a lot, but it's not going to be of any use to me. The only thing that I need is this picture, and the reason is the following. For me, when I understood that, it meant that there is something really deep is happening here. It means that for every fluid configuration that you give me that solves Navier-Stokes equations, I can plot a geometry. And because the geometry involves here both internal and extrinsic geometry. Now, because of that, all of turbulences I will explain is about the statistics of solutions of Navier-Stokes. It becomes the statistics of geometries, or what we can call random geometry. And in the language of physicists, it's part of quantum gravity. In two-dimensional theories, it's all of quantum gravity. In higher dimensions, it's not. To the people in the audience that know a little bit about the Kardar-Parisi-Zhang equation that describes a height growth of a surface, if you take the derivative of the height function, the gradient, then it satisfies the Burger's equation. Burger's equation is a model for one-dimensional turbulence. It's an integrable problem. But this is very similar in spirit to what I said. Because if you think about this as the horizon, and this is as the normal to the horizon, then this is like a fluid. Of course, the horizon is much more complicated. It's a null surface, co-dimension two. I mean, in details, it's not the same. Philosophically, it's the same. Now, what are the Navier-Stokes equations? The incompressible Navier-Stokes equations are the equations that describe the fluids at very low velocities compared to the speed of sound. And these are universal equations. Whatever you will do, at the end of the day, you will end up there. And they are basically Newton's equation. This is the acceleration. Because the density is constant, you can divide by it. These are the pressure forces. This is the viscous term. And this is random external force that you can add. If you want, you don't have to do it. And this is the incompressibility condition. In two dimensions, these equations known not to have finite blow-ups at finite time blow-ups. And the clay problem is in three dimensions to show that the same thing is happening there. Mind you, that this is not, blow-ups here are not shock waves because this is incompressible. So these are blow-ups of derivatives. And the analogous problem to this in general relativity is the problem of cosmic censorship. There is actually a deep relationship between the two. Now, this looks like a very simple equation, in fact, very simple to postulate. But what makes life very complicated is this nonlinear term. You cannot, in the turbulent regime, make it small. So it's what we call in field theory an order one coupling problem. There is no small expansion parameter. The only expansion parameter you can play with here is the number of dimensions. You can expand around d equal infinity. But even the d equal infinity case has not been solved. So in fact, you are basically clueless. The pressure is not an independent quantity, because if you will take a derivative of this equation and use this, you can relate it by a constraint, a non-local constraint, to the velocity. So basically, you are really interested in the velocity and its statistics. The rest will be determined. Now you can do two little calculations. You can multiply by VI the equation and sum over I, and you integrate over space. You will get that the change in the kinetic energy, the time derivative, is the flux minus the viscosity. And in steady state, this is zero. And therefore, the flux is equal to the dissipation. Now this is this right-hand side is very interesting. Because both numerically and experimentally, even if you take the limit that the viscosity is zero, this object is singular. And this always remains finite. And this is crucial for turbulence. If you will start with viscosity equal to zero and try to move on, you will not get the answer. It's the limit when the viscosity goes to zero. You define a dimensionless parameter. It's called the Reynolds number. And it's a characteristic length scale in the problem, the velocity difference at that scale, and divided by the viscosity. What does it do for you? It compares the nonlinear term 2D viscous term. If the nonlinear term is strong compared to the viscous term, you'll get turbulence. If the viscous term is stronger, then you will get something like honey, something very smooth. It's a dimensionless parameter that controls everything, and what is known is the following, that if it's at the order of 1,000 or more, you will observe numerically and experimentally a turbulent structure, and this is universal. It doesn't care whether it's electron fluid, whether it's wine, whether it's air, it doesn't matter. It's a universal result. The object of dissipation that I was talking about is very interesting as well, because a particle physicist or high energy physicist know about anomalies, quantum anomalies, and they think they invented it, the chiral anomalies. It's actually the anomaly exists already in this system, and it was known already to Onsager. This viscous term, or the viscosity, acts like a cutoff. And when you introduce it into the equation of Navier-Stokes without viscosity, you break time reversal symmetry. But when you take the limit where the cutoff, to remove the cutoff, namely viscosity goes to zero, this object remains finite. And therefore, you still break time reversal symmetry. Now, how do you know it? If you will look at the movie of turbulence, and then you will try to run it backwards, you will see something is odd about this. Time reversal will be broken, and this is called dissipative anomaly. There was a paper by Polyakov who actually showed it's the same mechanism as the chiral anomaly is working here. Now, turbulence reaches steady state, and this steady state, as I said, is far from equilibrium because there is always a flux there, and therefore, the Gibbs measure is not a good measure for it, and so we have to learn how to quantify its statistics. Now, turbulence in nature. As I told you, for environmental reasons, the viscosity is a very small number in our universe. For water, it's 10 to the minus 6 meters squared divided by seconds, and for air, it's a little bit less. I mean, it's a bigger number. The reason it's a bigger number is because we divided by the density. So if you take, so because this appears in the numerator of the Reynolds number, 10 to the minus 6, whatever you do here, you'll always get a big number. That's why you always see turbulence, whether you are steering your tea or you are swimming, you always create that. For instance, for an average river, you will get 10 to the 7, plug some numbers there. Now, the turbulent velocity field is very complex, both in space and in time as a signal. And even though the Navier-Stokes equations, they are deterministic if you don't have a random force, a single realization of a solution is unpredictable. So it doesn't help to try to use certain initial conditions and get a solution, because you change them a little bit, you'll get something totally different. And therefore, it was realized that instead of studying a solution, you should study individual solutions, you consider the statistics of the solutions. And as I said, because we can map it to geometrical objects, it's the statistics of geometries. Now, the statistics can be defined in various ways. For instance, you can have ensemble average over initial conditions. You can have a random force where you have always a flux and dissipation. This is called sustained or steady state turbulence. It turns out that in any way that you're doing it, you will get the same universal structure. Now, the numerical and experimental data show that statistical average properties, as I will explain, they have a universal structure. One defines the inertial range of scales, where L is the scale of the force, let's say or the box that I throw in the water, and little l is the viscosity, is the viscous scale. And then if you are in this regime, turbulence reaches steady state with statistical homogeneity and isotropy. Now, what are the objects to study? For instance, you can take a velocity at two different points, velocity of the fluid. You are interested in the equal, because it's steady state, you are interested in equal time correlation functions of the velocity field. Basically, correlations is what you measure in any physical system, and these are the objects that you want to study here. And what you can do is, for instance, take the difference between the two vectors at two different points, dotted with the vector that connects them. These are called longitudinal. You can also do it with the transverse. And then the experimental and numerical data show that if you look at the moments of this object, they scale like R to some powers. These are real numbers. These are universal numbers. They only depend on one parameter, the dimension. So if you do it in the atmosphere, which is two-dimensional, you will get certain numbers. If you do it in three dimensions, you'll get another number, and same in another set of numbers. This is an infinite set of numbers that you need to evaluate. Now, the most important contribution to this field, I mean, it's, by the way, this is pretty embarrassing because turbulence is everywhere. And despite the fact that it's everywhere, we don't know how to calculate these numbers. But the second embarrassing thing is that the most important work was not done by a physicist, but by a mathematician. And this is Kolmogorov. This is called K41 theory. It's Kolmogorov from the year 1941. And what he was saying is the following. It was known, actually, that there is a structure of cascades. If I throw a box in the water or I stir the water, then I create these big eddies. And they, due to instabilities, they start to split until there is a viscous scale, and then they decay. And he was thinking about this regime here that I was calling the inertial range, far from the viscosity and far from the force, and arguing that actually there is a motion of flux of energy without dissipation. Now, he was using actually some kind of a little bit sophisticated way, saying that he thinks that the probability distribution function has scale invariant structure, so it's determined by only one real parameter, h, and he determined it to be 1/3, so all the scaling exponents are n over 3. But in the physics language, it's a very simple thing what he did. He just did dimensional analysis. He just said the flux is constant. From that, he determined the dimensions of the velocity fields. And these are the exponents that at the time that he was using it, this argument, they were correct or consistent with the experimental data. In fact, it's actually he did it in the opposite way. He knew the data, and the data was consistent with these numbers. Now, interesting thing about the K41 theory is that because it was so successful, many people think that it is even correct. They think that, for instance, the energy spectrum, which is the two-point, is the structure functions of n equal to 2, just going to Fourier transform, scales like the energy scales like wave number to the power minus k over 3, they think this is a correct answer, as you will see it everywhere being shown. But it's actually a wrong answer. It doesn't fit the experimental and numerical data. So it's a very clever theory, but it's inconsistent. There is a deviation. But we also know what is the reason for the deviation. The reason for the deviation is called intermittency. And what is intermittency? I will show you a plot. This is not a signal of anything. This is called the devil's staircase function, and probably for good reason. And what is the property of this? The property of this function is that if you zoom, you don't get something which is self-similar, which is the property of scale invariant statistics. So instead of what people will call fractals, you will get something which is called multifractal. So zooming here or zooming here, you'll get something different. And you see it in the signals of turbulence. Suddenly, there is some noise, and then there is a calm period, et cetera, et cetera. This object is called intermittency. This quantity is called intermittency. And Kolmogorov assumption was missing this intermittency. Therefore, these linear scalings are incorrect. You will get some nonlinear scalings. So the self-similarity assumption misses the intermittency, and therefore, in order to calculate these real numbers, you need to understand how to calculate this intermittency. Schematically, I'll show you some numerical data and experimental later. If this is the linear scalings of Kolmogorov, these are the anomalous exponents, this is n, there is So a slight deviation, and then there's now the deviation will become bigger and bigger as when n is larger and larger. There is an agreement for n equal to 3, and this agreement is analytical. You can derive it analytically from Navier-Stokes equations. The exponent for n equal to 3 is 1, but it's the only result which is known to be an exact result. This other thing I'm not going to discuss related to Burger. So basically, the task is to calculate these differences for every n. There is infinite number of them. And for different dimensions, if you're interested in the general problem. So clearly, as I said, these nonlinear interactions are very strong. They are at all scales. You need some new good idea. And now I'll tell you what is the proposal. So I propose a very simple answer to the problem. And the answer is the following. If you want to know all the psi n's, all these exponents, basically the difference from Kolmogorov, you have to solve this simple quadratic equation where this is a number. It's one number for any dimension. It's one number for two dimensions, another number for three dimensions, et cetera, et cetera. Now, this number can be measured experimentally. And if it's measured, then it will give you all the other exponents. But I'm also going to relate it to scale or conformal anomaly. It will be scale anomaly, as I will explain in this. Now, this formula is known to some of you. This is called the Knizhnik-Polyakov-Zamolodchikov formula, not exactly with these values, but I will show you. The Knizhnik-Polyakov-Zamolodchikov formula came in the following way. For instance, suppose you take a two-dimensional model, like an Ising model, which has certain anomalous dimensions, scaling dimensions of the operators. And now you ask what will happen if you put it on a random surface. These dimensions will change. And this formula is the one that does it for you. Now, we first saw this we used this formula to fit data in a paper with Chris Elling. And then this year, I actually derived it. I will show you under what assumptions. And in this paper, maybe I will get to talk about it. It's about conformal invariants in these systems. After Kolmogorov's work in 1941, at some point it became clear that the formula that he was using is wrong. And one of the criticisms came from Landau, who told him that energy, local energy dissipation, is not a deterministic object. So you have to introduce some statistics into it. And they were trying these log normal distributions. They got into this formula. Obuchov was his student. They got it separately. And in 1962, they derived this formula. This formula is the limit of the previous one. Oops. Is of this one when you are taking the limit of small intermittency. And this formula at the time also was fitting the data, but it's inconsistent mathematically. Because if you will go to large n, it will tell you that the exponents are negative. So it was known not to be mathematically consistent, but it was fitting the data. So the formula of this Knizhnik-Polyakov-Zamolodchikov is a completion of this to high intermittency. Now, the interesting thing about this formula that I was showing you is that it has a generic prediction. If you go to large n, then what happens is that all the exponents will scale like a square root of n. So this is something that, in principle, you can check numerically or experimentally, verify or disprove the formula. And it's actually consistent with available data. We checked it in two dimensions. Actually, it's the only example where the data shows that Kolmogorov scaling works. So basically, you can determine from the structure function, the two-point function, if you want, that the intermittency is zero. You'll get all the scaling exponents. In three dimensions, this is the best data that we found from experiment. But the error bars are 1% on this. The data actually is not very good. In fact, you can fit it with many functions if you want. This is the numerical data. Same, we calculated for me this. There was some numerical data in four dimensions. In principle, it fits everything that exists, but this by itself is not a big deal. You can cook up other functions that do it. But there are certain predictions that you can easily check to see whether, I don't know if easily numerically, but you can check to see whether it's correct or not. Now I'm going to explain to you how to derive it according to the philosophy of this random geometry. So, as I told you, the Knizhnik-Polyakov's homologic of formula was came from what is understood as two-dimensional quantum gravity. People coupled matter to random geometry and asked what happens to the scaling exponents. But in fact, this is a special case of a more general mathematical result. And the more general mathematical result is the following. Suppose I have a set of numbers that I measure, like scaling exponents, with respect to a measure on RD, RD, the Euclidean space. So it's a Euclidean measure, the Lebesgue measure on RD. Now suppose somebody introduces a new measure, random measure, in the following way. He takes the Lebesgue measure, but he multiplies it by e to the gamma phi. Gamma is a number, where this phi is a random field. So in this case, I will take it to be a Gaussian random field that has log covariance. So actually, it has log covariance and that contributes a lot when x minus y is very small. What will happen to those scaling exponents that I was measuring with respect to d mu? By the way, I could have taken here something much more general than Gaussian, and you will get some other formula. But for the KPZ, this is what is needed. Then the answer will be the KPZ formula. And I have two tasks now. First, I have to explain to you where can you get a random field like this, or random measure, in turbulence. I'm doing turbulence in ordinary flat space or any ordinary Euclidean space in general. Nothing is random about it. So where am I going to get this? And how am I going to calculate this quantity? So these are the two questions. So the philosophy is that it should work like coupling to random geometry, but where will I get these guys? And the first thing I'm going to explain is that this one is an Abu-Goldstone mode. I'm going to interpret Kolmogorov scaling as a spontaneous symmetry breaking. And then I will relate the intermittency parameter to to scale anomaly. Okay, so this will be, I'm not going to do all the details, but at least the flavor of the analysis. Okay. Let me begin with scale symmetry breaking. If you look at the Navier-Stokes equations in the absence of viscosity, this is called the Euler equation, then it has two symmetries. It has many symmetries, but two important symmetries. You can scale separately space and separately time. Here I picked z to be an arbitrary real number. I could have put here lambda 1 and lambda 2. So it's very easy to check. It has separate scale and time symmetries. I will denote a breaking of these two symmetries to a particular value of dynamic exponent, z star, in this way. Now the flux at the boundary, that's what it does. It breaks the symmetry, and it breaks it to which value? You can evaluate what's the dimension of the flux, set it to zero, you'll get its 1/3. So what is actually the Kolmogorov theory? The Kolmogorov theory is there is a flux at infinity, it's like a boundary. I'm in the inertial range, and it spontaneously breaks the separate scale and time symmetries that I had to a diagonal group with a particular value of dynamic exponents. So, okay, it's nice. We don't need to do the Kolmogorov analysis. We can interpret it as, in this way, as a spontaneous symmetry breaking. But then, when there is a spontaneous symmetry breaking, you expect a gapless mode. How do I find this gapless mode? If this is the flux, then I just shift it with some number and some field tau, and I try to find the action of this guy. That's the dilaton. And I can construct this dilaton action. Now, this dilaton action is a very cute action. In fact, here I'm discussing even dimensions. In odd dimensions, it's a little bit more complicated. And the reason why it's in BD is because I'm thinking about a sphere and where the flux comes, and then there is some dissipation, and I'm in the inertial range. It has only two terms in the inertial range. One is, and how do I determine it? Just by symmetries. One is an object that will give you low correlation. And the second is a topological term. This is called the Euler density. In fact, in conformal geometry, it's called Q curvature. It's something a little bit more general. But for the case that I'm interested in on the sphere, it will be the Euler density. But because the sphere, the metric in the bulk is flat, it's actually given something only from the boundary. And this is, those of you who know Liouville theory in two dimensions, this is the conformal field theory generalization of Liouville theory to higher dimensions. In fact, Liouville action, the classical solutions are constant curvature solutions. This will be constant Q curvature solutions. It's a conformal field theory. There are many other terms, but they're all suppressed in the inertial range. So the dilaton, it has a very, very simple action. And not just that it has a very simple action, it is has logarithmic covariance. So I will interpret the field in the random measure as this dilaton. This object is like a background charge. It's very easy to check that if you do a shift of the field, you'll acquire a charge, et cetera. This is the only free parameter here, because you can, I mean, there are in principle two, but you can absorb one here. This number is related to the intermittency. It's the one that will be related to the intermittency. And there is now work with my students on this conformal field theory. We are trying to understand it's a non-unitary or non-reflection positive. It's Euclidean space. And in fact, it's interesting to try even to solve it. One of my students checked that using symmetries, the log is the only thing that's available in flat space. Another student, we calculate the three-point function so you can solve this theory in a bootstrap way, et cetera, et cetera. But it will not be important for me for this talk. So now I'm proposing what is going to be turbulence field theory. It's basically K41 theory, to which I was breaking it spontaneously, coupled to this dilaton. So it's like in the days of two-dimensional quantum gravity, it's like coupling a conformal field theory to the Liouville field. And here comes the assumption. The assumption is that the dilaton will couple in a way that it dresses these operators. And it's very similar to the way it was done in two-dimensional quantum gravity. The intermittency parameter, as I will show you, will be related to the anomaly. This is something that was bothering me all the time. I always thought that it will be something that has to do with conformal or scale anomaly. But this exists only in even dimensions. And turbulence exists in any dimension. But if it's the boundary anomaly, this exists in any dimension. And this was resolving for me this puzzle that I had. It's different than two-dimensional quantum gravity in many aspects. One of them is these fields that I'm talking about, let's say the K41 and the tau field, the dilaton, they are all functions of the same field, the velocity and the pressure, while in two-dimensional quantum gravity, the Liouville is separated. Also, diffeomorphisms are not important, et cetera. The theory is non-unitary, but that's clear because there is a leak of charges. And the symmetries, it will have a translation, rotation, a scale invariance. We will discuss the issue of conformal invariance when you have time. Now you follow your nose. If you accept my assumptions that I'm going to build the operators of turbulence by dressing by this dilaton all the operators of this Kolmogorov theory, which I don't know what they are, but it doesn't matter for me. It's very easy to prove this formula. Namely, any change in the dimensions of these operators to the actual dimensions is this formula that you recognize from before. And these ones, if I take K41 theory, these are n over 3. This will prove the formula. Okay? Now comes the last part. How do I calculate this number? I mean, in principle, the number here, I could measure. I need to measure only one structure function, and then I give you infinite number of predictions. But you would also be interested in, can we calculate it from first principles? And there is a first principle that allows you to calculate it. I don't know the number. I will tell you what are the complications in the actual calculation. And this is the so-called bulk or conformal or scale anomaly. Originally, I thought it's a conformal anomaly. I know now that it's not. It's really the whole scale anomaly. The difference between them is subtle. There are more terms in the scale anomaly. But because my boundary is a sphere, it doesn't matter. They all scale, all the curvature scales like 1 over the size to the power d, and therefore it's just have to collect the number in front. But anyway, it's known that on curved spaces, or in our case, because of the boundary, there is an anomaly, the trace of the stress energy tensor, which is zero when there is scale or conformal anomaly, is non-vanishing. And the way I'm going to calculate it by requiring a complete cancellation of this anomaly. And the reason is the following. I don't want these universal exponents to depend on the scale. In two-dimensional quantum gravity, there was a different logic that was used. The idea was that conformal symmetry was a gauge symmetry, and it was very important to preserve it. Here, I don't want the universal results to depend on that scale. If I do that, there are some steps in the paper. I can calculate this quantity related to the dimension. This object is the sum of the anomalies of the Dilaton action and this Kolmogorov theory, which I'll tell you a little bit about. There's some numerics that you have to do. There are two branches. You have to pick the branch, et cetera. It's very similar to two-dimensional quantum gravity. But at the end of the day, you can calculate it. If I know this and this, I will give you the answer. The Dilaton, it's very easy to calculate. I know the conformal field theory. I can give you the answer. This one is more complicated. It's a non-local theory, and it's a non-unitary theory, and there are certain subtleties in that. But how much time do I have, by the way? I'm OK? A few minutes? Five, perfect. Yeah, perfect. You can, let me tell you. So I calculate it as a function of this scale anomaly parameter, which I don't know how to fix. But I can check what it will do with experiment. So first, I can check two-dimensional turbulence. In two dimensions, by the way, there are two cascades. There is a cascade to large scales, and there is a cascade to small scales. One is called energy, the other is entropy. And I'm talking about the energy cascade. And there, as I told you, the data shows that the intermittency should be zero. Kolmogorov should work. But how can I check it? There is an independent calculation, numerical calculation, by a group of, is a very nice paper from 2006. Of a group of people that checked isovorticity lines, and they found that they follow what is known as SLE curves with some parameter. And this parameter can be related to the central charge of the theory. What they found is that the curves have this kappa equal to 6, and if you will put it here, you will get C equal to 0. What does it mean? It means that this is very similar to the case in two-dimensional quantum gravity of C equal 26, namely, there is no Dilaton, there in the Liouville mode, and there is no dressing. If I go to higher dimensions, for instance, three-dimensional, I can evaluate the quantity. It's of order 1. And if you want just to get a feeling of it, it's like about 1,000 scalars. Why 1,000 scalars, I don't know, but that's the number. If I go to higher dimensions, like large D in 4, it's also something around 1,000 scalars. I do not know the answer at infinite D, because there are some details of the branches that you have to. Here you need to know a little bit something more about these values of this parameter. There is a conjecture that we set up many years ago. We proposed that the all exponents go to 1 in this limit, because it looks like Burger's turbulence, but nobody has proven it. So I'm not sure about that. And I think I can summarize in the following way. I propose a following solution of turbulence. It's a mean field theory, this K41 theory, coupled to the Dilaton. It's a conformal field theory. The Dilaton comes from a spontaneous symmetry breaking, and it dresses the operators of this Kolmogorov. If I accept that, I can derive this KPZ formula, and I can relate this intermittency parameter to the scale anomaly. There are many predictions of these formulas, for infinite number of predictions, but one which is very generic is this one, that they scale like square root of n for large n. So I'm talking with a few of the numerical guys, how far they can go. The values that they have at the moment cannot disprove or prove any of this. It would be also important to understand a little bit better what is the reason for these statistics, what are the configurations that contribute to that. And of course, more than that, you can go to higher point correlation functions, etc. Thank you.
One or two questions.
Okay.
One or two questions. Yes.
So, Yaron, when at which end Kolmogorov-Obuchov starts to contradict to experimental data?
Probably, first of all, it contradicts because, as you see, it has negative values, right?
I feel to.
You are saying whether up to 10 it will agree or not?
Yes.
It's I don't know. Probably up to 10, maybe it can work as well.
No, but people went up to 12 in experimental.
No, it's a nobody's trying to exclude this formula because they know it's wrong anyway, right?
Yes.
So, but there are other formulas in the market that can fit up to 10. People cooked up all kinds of formulas.
No,
to
but
do
all
that.
Of Kolmogorov is just quadratic correction. Okay, so it says that it's squared, right? So it's the simplest one.
Is the simplest one, yeah.
But then at n equal 10, it's still okay.
I don't know. We have to check with this 1%. I don't know. Maybe the order 10 is already, you can say that it's wrong. But anyway, it's wrong because.
I know that the principle
is
wrong.
So why is it important at which n exactly?
Because you have to know to which n you have to go to see actually the real deviation from the whole thing.
Well, I think that if you will go probably, or you have to deviate not just from this formula, but from the others. But I guess if you will get, I don't know, 14, 15, 16, whatever, one of these values you already see.
But square root of n.
No, you don't need to get the square root. You will get a detailed number, right? You will just plot the curve. The square root is maybe you need much more. But just to see the numerics, probably 15 or something, you can already see that it deviates from all the others, yeah.
No, but if I would prove square root experimentally, okay, then...
You don't need to prove only the square root experimentally. You can also just measure, you know, I don't know, 20 or 30 of them, if it works, it works, right? Yeah.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. So I think it's a numerical... In principle, it's a question of computing. It's not...
Perhaps we can ask the speaker questions during lunch, okay?
Okay.
Right, so we go to the next... Talk. Let's put our hands together to thank the speaker.